Time brings pain. Time brings wisdom. Time inspires. Time brings purpose. Time heals all sorrows. This is Beauty for Ashes.
I got away from a lot of the snakes in the pit, but unfortunately, I did get bitten, and I didn't know it until it was too late. And the venom began to slowly creep up in the form of lust. You see, the guy that I had met and dealt with, that I skipped school with, introduced me to some very lustful things. He introduced me to masturbation and all of those things. And if you've ever dealt with this, if you're dealing with this now, this is a deep, dark hole that you don't want to be a part of, because as soon as you think that you're done with it, as soon as you think you've made up your mind and you've crossed the threshold and you're not going to deal with it anymore, it slowly creeps back in. When you least expect it, and you feel so defeated, you feel so torn, you feel so shameful, you feel so guilty because of the things that you've done. And maybe you're not like that. Maybe you're okay with it. Maybe because someone on TV said that it's healthy, that you should do it and it's good for your body, you don't feel any type of way against it. But you need to know that it's something that will put a major stronghold, a major blockage in happiness, love, and affection on your life. And you have to let go of it. And God will help you let go of it. You see, my journey was a very long journey, a journey for almost a decade of shamefulness, of doubt, of hiding it, of trying to run away from it and it catching up back with me, until one day I decided, you know what, I'm not going to let this take over me anymore. It's either me or you, and it's not going to be me. If I want to lay in my bed and have peace and not have lustful thoughts, I will have it. And I found myself laying in bed fighting those thoughts, and I would fight it over and over again. And I'm not telling you that it wasn't an easy journey. I'm not telling you that it was simple. But one thing I did learn is, because I really wanted it to let go of me, to loose its hold off of my life, I began to pray. And every time it would come over me, or I would feel the urge coming, I would get on my knees as fast as I could and pray. You see, by the age of 17, lust had entered my life. I had already been smoking and drinking. I also had a very, very foul mouth. I know, right? Unbelievable, right? But I had a very, very smart mouth. I had a foul mouth. It probably wasn't anything that I would not say for a laugh or just because. And through this journey, I learned that the enemy, the devil, wants to pervert my mouth. He wanted to pervert my mouth. He wanted nothing but bad to come out of my mouth, to pollute the earth, to pollute my spirit. Because he knew that my mouth would be a weapon. He knew that if I ever realized who I was, if I ever came into myself, my mouthpiece would change the heart of many nations, would change the hearts of many people. And now I'm here today because I realized that there was power in my mouth, and the perverse things didn't belong there. But throughout this journey, throughout the teenage years, the early adult years, I faced many relationship situations that I feel like I need to share with you. Because we as women, as young girls, we are faced with so many things, so many repetitive situations that no one ever shines light into, because many of us have not yet been delivered from them. Situation number one, rule number one, always follow your first mind. If you ever meet someone and a red flag goes up, if you ever encounter a guy and you don't like him at first and he has to grow on you, he's not it. He's not the one. Because no one should have to grow on you. And as like my husband has mentioned before, no one's a fungus. You know, funguses grow on you. You shouldn't have a person have to grow on you, or you have to tolerate them in order to like them. If you have to do this, then they are not the one. You need to run as fast as you can. Just turn and go the other way. And you can't even be friends, really, because this person is not a person that you necessarily like. You just tolerate them. You tolerate their behavior. You tolerate the way they touch you. You tolerate the way they show affection. And you really want, you want hugs. You're a hugger, but they don't like hugs. You want kisses and affection, and they don't like to do that. Or this person is just all physical and they're all sexual and they don't want to give you quality time. Go with your first mind. Trust your heart. Trust your spirit. Trust yourself. And know if that's not what you want, you don't have to settle for it. There's much more. There's greater for you somewhere else. You know, I always thought that because I didn't like my body, or because I didn't have many guys try to talk to me, that I should just take advantage of what was given. That I would be able to change this person if I didn't like them. I would be able to change something about them, the way they dress, the way they talk, even their body type. Or maybe I would just accept it even though I didn't like their body type or their height. I settled in a lot of ways. During this period, from I could say 15 to 24 or 25, I settled on a lot of guy friends because I didn't realize that God actually was hearing and paying attention to everything I wanted, even at a very young age. And you see, I got myself in crazy relationships. I got myself into a relationship with a very short guy that wasn't very smart, and I decided that, oh, since he was the most handsome guy I thought that I had been with thus far, and he was showing me some type of attention, then he must be my husband. He must be the one that I'm supposed to be with. He's Christian, his family's Christian. You know, he's musically inclined, he's funny, and we always get caught up on the funny guy, ladies. We always like to laugh. We always get caught up on the silly person that's the life of the party. And he was young, and I was a little bit older than him. I was already in college, and he was going off to another college. And we weren't even in a committed relationship. There was no ring on my finger. He wasn't calling me his girlfriend. I wasn't calling him my boyfriend. And we had been physical in some ways. And I lusted him, and I thought that I loved him. But it was really lust, because I was already dealing with that. And I was looking at his physical body. I was looking at, you know, the laughter, the jokes, and all of that. And I end up settling for the things that he was. And I messed around and told him that I would wait on him until he got back. I would wait on him until he finished school. And I would be here waiting. Ladies, don't ever tell a guy, a man, that you will be waiting on him without one of these, because he will not come back. He will not stay faithful at all. When I tell you, he was in another relationship, and he had a totally different life where he was, and his family was in on it. His mother was loyal to him and not loyal to me. So no matter how you think that you're in on it, or I got his bank account, or I'm driving his car, or he's staying with me, he's not going to stay committed. He is not going to stay faithful. He will let you continue to sit there in your dorm room, not talk to anybody, turn down people, sit there in your room, sit there in your house, and think that y'all both are on the same page and that y'all are working toward the same goal, and he is going to do what he wants to do because he has not committed to you. And if he wants to commit to you, he will take the necessary steps to be with you. He will move every woman, every person out of the way when he wants to be with you. He will get the ring. He will take care of you. He will make sure that you're happy and that you're loved and you get all the affection and the attention that you need if he wants you. If he does not want you, he will do the opposite, or he will leave some things out. But if you continue to give up the loving, to cook, clean, and all of this stuff without a commitment, he is going to continue to run around on you. He is going to continue to misuse and abuse you. And what happens to us? We end up with the broken heart. We end up finding the numbers. We end up finding the lipstick on the collar. We end up being all in shambles over someone that we knew from the beginning would not make the right commitment, take the necessary steps, because we failed to follow our first mind and the red flags. And maybe you didn't see it, maybe he was just so charming and maybe he was just so believable, but we as women, we must have some standards in place, some things in line that we know will make sure that this person is going to do what they say they're going to do. You need to make sure that you won't be giving it up until he makes the necessary steps, the necessary changes. He has to show you that he wants you. We have become so easy. We have become so thirsty for attention that we settle for the wrong ones. If you know he's abusive, if you heard that he's abusive, don't ever think that he won't hit you. Don't ever think that he won't verbally abuse you. If he cheats on his wife, he will cheat on you. We need to get this out of our heads that our stuff is so good that it's going to keep a man in our bed. It's going to keep a man faithful to us when it's not, because he's wondering about how her stuff is and how good her stuff will be. We have to have some standards. We have to realize that there's still good men out there. Don't get me wrong, there's still men that will be faithful, but we have to be patient. We have to take time to listen to the Lord, and we have to move lust out of the way, first of all, because lust will get you every time. You look at them muscles, you look at them abs, you look at that smile. Oh, he got some of what I like, but not all of what I like. I can work with it. No, we need to slow down, take a breather. Follow your first mind. Pray about everything, because guys, it's a lot of people that are sent out to take advantage of you, and the enemy will use what's your weakness. He will use men and even women to take you down and bring you down. Guys lie and guys will cheat, and guys also talk to their friends. And they tell them what you're doing. They tell them all about everything that's going on. And for a perfect example, I had a friend. We were very close. I used to spend the night at his house. We did absolutely nothing. He didn't even kiss me. He didn't fondle me in the middle of the night. None of that. Come to find out, him and his friend, my friend was talking to his friend. His friend mentions that me and him have had sex. What? But in all this time, we have never touched like that. We didn't even have a relationship like that. But just because he said that we did, so he wouldn't look strange, so he wouldn't look funny. You need to know that guys talk, and you need to watch your actions and watch who you trust with your treasures, with your body, because God wants to do something spectacular with you. And I said all of that because this is the ugly. This is the good, bad, and the ugly. But the good, bad, and the ugly brings wisdom. It brings peace. It brings beauty out of these dark situations, and I went through so that you wouldn't have to go through. I went through so I can pull you out and help you make it to the other side. Look, God has so much purpose. God has a great plan for you. And these times that you have spent, this time of sorrow, this time of healing, this time of joy that you've encountered within your life was not for nothing, but it was to grow you. It was to make you stronger. And if you're struggling in these areas, if you're feeling like there's no one out there for you, if you feel like you're going to be lonely for the rest of your life, or you tried marriage one time, or you tried it twice and it just didn't seem like it would ever work out, and I'll just probably be alone for the rest of my life, there is still hope for you. God has given you the necessary tools, and God will give you the necessary tools to break through the barriers in your heart, to break the strongholds, to break the yokes, so that you can enjoy the beauty that He has promised you. Ladies, this has been another Crown Jewel Effect. You have just been crown jeweled. Go back and watch Beauty for Ashes part one. I guarantee if you haven't seen it, it will bless your soul. Share this on Facebook. Share it with your friends. Share it with your family, because we are better together. We affect each other together. We have all been through. We all have broken pieces that need to be put back together. We're broken vessels where God fills in our cracks. He polishes us. He changes our blemishes and makes us beautiful. And He said, I will give you the oil of joy. He will anoint your head with the oil of joy, and He will give you beauty for ashes. Ladies, you be blessed, and we shall meet again next week.